The Hills Cricket Club celebrated its 50th anniversary in 2019. An evening of nostalgia was held in October 2019 to commemorate this achievement.
To the beautiful Indian country that I love.
Martin Russell, president of the Hills Cricket Club, opened proceedings with some words of welcome.
Members, deputy, friends of the Hills, you're more than welcome here to this nostalgic evening. So I only hope you enjoy the evening. I'd like just to thank Jim and the committee that set out to organise this and get it up and running, and I'd like to thank you very much for that.
Seamus Clinton was a founder member of the Hills Cricket Club and has held every office in the club during the 50 years of its existence. He has been a captain, treasurer, fixture secretary and president of the Hills Cricket Club.
The seeds of this club were actually sown by Balruddery Cricket Club. In 1968, Balruddery were finding it hard to field two teams. So they asked five lads from the Hills to go down and help to field the teams in 1968. So Jemmy Bourne Sr., Joe Clinton and Joe Cleary, the late Joe Cleary, and Jimmy Bourne Jr. and myself played for 2 years with Balruddery. And that was in 68 and 69, like towards the end of the 69 season, the Hills had a team in the Fingal League, and there was talk, like, you know, amongst the lads, and there was the younger born lads that were the younger borns then, and we had got a taste for playing cricket in Dublin, wanted to form our own club. So the five lads that were in Balruddery, plus Joe Hoare and Johnny Archer, they said they would play, and then there were other people that did, playing for the Hills in the Fingal League that didn't play for Balruddery or the Man of War. And then it was decided, like, towards the end of 69, that we would form our own club. So, but anyway, there was an approach made to Captain Wenches, like, to see if there's any possibility he could give us a field. Like, the initial approach was done by Joe Clinton, Richard Dunn, and David Morta. And the captain, like, you know, he agreed, like, you know, which was staggered us a bit to some extent. So then the next thing was, once we had a field, we said we'd have an AGM. So we went to we organised an AGM for October 69 in the Home Patrick Hotel. And on that, the meeting was chaired by the late Jerry Bourne, and there was about 14 people at the meeting. There was five Bournes or six Bournes. There was Jemmy Bourne, Jerry Bourne, Jimmy Bourne Jr., Anthony Bourne, Martin and Paddy Bourne, and Richard Bourne. And Johnny Archer, Joe Hoare, myself and Joe Clinton, David Morta, The Flash, Jimmy Howard, and John Morta also attended the meeting, but John subsequently went to Australia that winter. So there was an agreement made with Captain Wenches and Mrs. Wenches, like, that in the spring we were able to prepare a wicket in the middle of the field. The captain cut the grass and the rest of the field, and we mowed and prepared the wicket. And the first cricket matches were played when the grass was cut. Like, but the first match we played in Leinster cricket was in civil services ground. We played a club called St John Bosco, and we arrived up there to play sometime in May 1970. And I would honestly say, like, that the Dublin senior team going into an All Ireland wouldn't have been as revved up as much as we were that day going up to civil service. Like, we were actually high on adrenaline, like. And we batted first, made 180 odd runs, which on wickets that wouldn't be that good was a lot of runs.
Johnny Archer was captain of the first 11 from 1971 to 1974, during a period of great success for the club. The Hills won its first trophy in Leinster League cricket when it beat Pembroke at the Carlisle Ground in 1971.
That was the first cup we won, and it was a great achievement, for the club. But one thing about the club at that stage, when we did win a trophy, we did celebrate. That was one thing about it. We always celebrate. We went out on Monday night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night, Thursday night. We had a rest on Friday night, and we played cricket on Saturday.
The Hills won the Irish Junior Cup in 1975 when it beat Zingari in the final. Zingari were Cliftonville's third 11, and the name means travellers because the club had been burned out of its ground. Martin Russell was one of the stars on that occasion.
We opened the innings and lost two very early wickets. And as a result of losing the two early wickets, Nick Farrell came to the wicket. And Nick ended up playing very steadily. We had to, but quite lucky in it that William Irwin, who was the opening bowler, went over on his ankle and had to go off. And so we, as I said, we made 200 runs, and then they came in to bat. Now they only batted for the 40 overs in it, and that was down to very good bowling from Liam Archer, who took three for 20, and Martin Bourne, who took three for 22. And the Hills won easily.
The successes in junior cricket inspired the club to look for membership of senior cricket. As the Hills teams worked up the grades, pressure was also coming on now to improve facilities. And in 1977, a new clubhouse was erected. It was a wooden structure because there were still issues in terms of tenure. And 16th of September 1977 was a great day because all of the great and the good of Leinster cricket came out to assist in the opening of the clubhouse. It was opened by Des Cashel, a Skerries man who was president of the Leinster Cricket Union. And in the game that was played after it, there were some fantastic performances from Hills players against current internationals.
I remember we were a little junior club and junior players, cap in hand, going to play in this match against half a dozen international cricketers. But moving on to Joey Archer, left-hand bat, he could lose balls in the game, and there didn't have to be woods around the place to lose. But there's a guy by the name of Stan Oakes, Jim, wasn't it? He was an Irish international bowler. And I think Joe left him in the woods about five or six times.
The Hills Cricket Club has a well-deserved reputation for its hospitality. And this is thanks to the many excellent ladies' committees at the club over the years. Mary Clinton will speak to us about the work of the ladies' committees.
Year old, I learned a lot from the late Mrs. Dwyer and Margaret Dunn. Mrs. Dwyer taught us all very well. It was important, she said, to put the butter on sparingly. She would say to me, put it on, Mary, with one side of the knife and scrape it off with the other. Over 42 years ago, another very important time for our committee was ladies' committee, were the annual motorbikes. The motorbike weekend went from Thursday, Friday and Saturday. The pits were in the field. We made sandwiches for the three events in the little small dressing room in the old clubhouse. While the ladies in the kitchen made soup by the gallon, Olive and my ma'am, the late Maggie Byrne, were the soup experts. My father would encourage them to put more salt into it, so they would go down and buy the minerals off him at the far end. However, things that remain the same over the 50 years is the hospitality. The Hills ladies, all down through the years, have shown and continues to do so to all our visitors who come to our club. Many thanks to all concerned.
In 1982, The Hills played our neighbours Balrothery in the final of the Senior 2 Cup. And this was crucially important because it was going to have a vital bearing on the quest for senior cricket. And this evening we have with us Gerry Harper, who scored 111 runs in that game.
So I was so determined that we were going to win that match today, that day. And I was just lucky enough.
Any chances, Gerry? No, it's all...
Joey says I was dropped before I scored. One thing about today was I was playing against Noel. And the previous week we played by Rodri here. And I remember scoring 59 in the match. And I said to Noel, whatever you do next week, don't go round the wicket to me. So he was bowling away, he was bowling well, everything was going as normal. And the next thing he said to the umpire, I'll go round the wicket. So he came into me and I hit him for a six. And I said to him, no, I told you not to go round the wicket to me. And he said, would you ever, ever?
Sure, yeah.
And there's a couple of memories I had. And another one was Johnny Archer when I think I was around about 98 at the time. And I could hear Johnny on the line, will you stop blocking and hit that ball?
Matt Dwyer is going to speak about the tortuous process it was for the Hills to gain membership to senior cricket and also give us an insight into what it was like to play senior cricket for the first time.
We were trying to break into the higher echelons of senior cricket, and nobody really wanted to come down here to play. So it was a closed shop, so you had to get a vote, get the senior votes to get into senior. So in winning leagues and cups, although not every year, at senior two, we were applying for senior status. So we didn't have toilets, so that was the first year. So we got toilets that next year and we played again, and then we didn't have something else, and so we got that next year. So for about 3 or 4 years we had to run the gauntlet of finding out why we weren't allowed into senior. So eventually we were winning sort of leagues and cups, and the second teams of senior cricket clubs said, can you get the shower out of senior two, because they're beating us every year. So eventually we got voted in by the Leinster clubs, and we actually had to put an artificial pitch in from grass pitches, because our pitches weren't deemed to be good enough. So we put in an artificial cricket pitch just after CYM did it, and they got success. So we moved on from there. The amount of work that was done by a number of people to actually persuade people to vote for us. For example, you sort of sat around clubs buying drinks for presidents, so you'd influence them a wee bit. It's a bit like what was happening now with the old brown envelope job, like, you know. But it was a point, or you'd buy for a president or a chairman or something like that to get their vote. But it wasn't an easy time. In fairness, we probably lost 4 or 5 years of good cricket. Had we been promoted when we should have been promoted, I'm sure the guys would have transformed to senior cricketers, because senior cricket was a serious step up. Like, you know, we were just junior cricketers. We put four lads on one side of the field and four lads on the other side, and you bowled. The best bowler opened the bowling, the next best bowled then, and so on. There was no such thing as bringing the spinners on or bringing the seamer on or the swinger on. But we learned a big lesson up in Rathmines one day when we played in the Senior Cup, the very first senior match. And we were chasing leather around all day when Brian Buttermer and Jack Short and a few others gave us a bit of a lesson on cricket. I probably learned more afterwards in the bar speaking to David Kent and John Wills and Jack Short and Brian Buttermer. I probably learned more on that hour after the game than I learned for sort of 5 or 6 years. But yeah, interesting times. It's a pity we didn't get senior cricket probably 2 or 3 years earlier. The lads would have been much better cricketers.
From the mid-1980s onwards, it was evident that in addition to the men's teams, there should also be a women's team. And various people contributed a lot, the likes of Joe Caprani, John Archer. But our treasurer, Anne Murphy, is going to talk about the early years of women's cricket in the Hills Cricket Club.
Yeah, the ladies started off in 1988, but what the game the year before that happened, that started the ladies off in the first place, was there was 30 women got out on the field, which was all the tea ladies, every woman in the club, got out to play a friendly. So we were 15 aside, outside, and the men were doing the teas for a change. There was Margaret Dunn, Mary Clinton, Maggie Byrne, Maureen Byrne, like literally everybody was out in that field. I think myself and Antonis Stapleton were the two youngest people on the field. And Jeanette Archer and the whole lot of us, we got out and for a skit, and the men done the tea. I can remember Anthony Byrne wearing the chef's hat when he was serving the tea to us, and Mick Dwyer. And of course, as ladies do, when they have a cup of tea, if anyone smokes, we had the tea, the ladies then started having their cigarette and their chat and all that, and some of the lads turned around and said, ladies, you do know there's a second half to this match. We have to go out and finish it. So that's how we started. A year later, we were talking about starting up a ladies team then for about a year and a half after that. And in 1988, a good few, there was 30, because I came across notebooks and stuff the other night when I was looking for photographs. So there was about 30 of us. In those days, the players came from the secondary school in Skerries and from the hockey team. That's how Marguerite Burke, Linda Jenkinson, and all of them joined us. From the school then was Linda Moore and Cathy Carey and the whole lot of us. In 1989, they won the Division 3 and Cup winners. And then we went on to, which you'll see the photograph, which is the most common one, was I had left for a couple of years, or a year anyway, and then was asked to come back because the person that asked me to come back felt that it was starting to fall apart. So I came back, and myself and Johnny Archer got the ladies going again, and there was 25 of us, I think, were down to North Kildare. We were in the Minor Cup Final and the Junior Cup Final. So I was managing the ladies at that stage, and Johnny was the coach. Now, at the start, we got an awful lot of support from Johnny and Joe Caprani, who used to come down and coach us here on a Friday night, was our training night. The selection committee was myself, Jeanette, and Antoinette Stapleton. We literally bought our own gear. Now, where everybody has gear now, their own gear, and they have their own bats, their own gloves, everything. In those days, we actually had three sets of... We had a big cricket gear bag with three sets of pads, one for the smaller girls, and the other two then were the average size. Three bats, a cricket ball that lasted the whole season, because in those days it was the red leather balls, and you polished it up with Mr. Pledge, so I mean, it was really shiny and got us through the whole season. No waste, definitely no waste. Wicket-keeping gloves. I think Maura Doris was the wicket-keeper at the time. And so we were thrilled to bits with this gear. Like, we thought we were great. We were going around with our big bag of gear in the boot of the car. When the gear would start ripping, we actually used catgut to sew it. But that's what we started off with. And that's how basic we were at the time. So we've come an awful long way since then.
The first successes for the Hills in senior cricket occurred in 1989. And we'll have Mark Clinton, the double winning captain, to talk to us about that year.
89 came around. It's unbelievable to think it's actually 30 years ago now, Jim, at this stage. But it was just our time. I mean, you look at that team, just if you go back to that, I mean, you know, that particular sort of 12-person squad, and there was others in there in terms of Patrick and Liam as well. I mean, they were just an outstanding group of cricketers. And just going back to what Matt had said earlier on, unfortunately, it would have been great if these guys had got senior cricket a bit earlier. Because, you know, the actual ability that these guys had and the structure that we had on the team that particular year. Now, I was just fortunate enough to take the toss that time, really, because these guys were so experienced and, you know, we just put a little bit of extra structure on it. And amazingly, and I'm a huge believer in momentum in cricket, in any sport, really, but particularly in cricket. And we won so many tosses that year, which basically can influence cricket matches greatly. Now, Dad would be able to tell me exactly how many because he was keeping tabs at the time. But I think we certainly went maybe sort of seven games in a row, Jim, where we were actually winning tosses, which really enabled us to put ourselves in a great position when you've got guys like Martin Byrne, Noel Harper, and Matt coming into bowl, then Paddy and other people as well contributing. It was terrific. But really, from my perspective, it was such an important period in our cricket club. because it really, it meant that we'd just arrived in terms of, you know, these two particular competitions we'd won. There's one game that sticks to my mind. Early on in the season, we went to Claremont Road to play against a very good YMCA side with Messrs. Dunlop, Lewis, Gart, Burns, and hosts of other names, Nulty, etc. And we won, okay? And that was kind of a big, big, you know, yardstick for us. And I remember everyone having pints afterwards and say, you know, we can actually beat anyone now. And we went on all the way through that season. Unfortunately, we just, you know, slipped up at the end in not getting to the 50-over final, but it was a terrific year. And of course, that famous final against Carlisle, 8-3, Alan, were we? 8-3 when you come into bat? You know, how Curley didn't get man of the match, I don't know. But anyway, no, listen, it was a tremendous, effort from everybody that particular day.
We've already heard that Alan Correll got man of the match that day, and Alan is now going to speak to us about his memories of that famous day.
Just one very quick memory was of the pitch invasion after the match. It was just absolutely incredible. The first person that I saw was Simon Hoare. Like, you know, I don't know what age Simon was at the time, excuse me if I don't know, but it was an unbelievable feeling to see 11 of us standing out at the wicket and then seeing this amount of people coming on. It just meant, it was unreal. It was fantastic. Great memories.
Michael Dwyer was chairman when the new clubhouse was built in 1995. Some of the photographs accompanying this clip relate to a later refurbishment.
You see, following on from a great success on the pitch in 89 when we won the double, we felt it that we needed to move on a bit off the pitch, and therefore we always were looking for to get permission to build a clubhouse on, by the way, not on our own ground. It was the Wenches ground still. But I think it started off in 92, someone could correct me if I'm wrong there. We came down one evening and there was a lock and chain on the gate. Now, this was a bit like the Brexit thing now. Things had come to a head and we must have fallen foul of our landlords over the way there, because he went and locked the gate and said, look, we have to go. My God, I remember well, and everyone else, I think, would as well. It was devastating. We said, this is it, it's gone, the club is gone. You know, but funny enough, that was the catalyst for to start negotiations. Leo and your man Boris could take a leaf out of it. But we started negotiations about the new clubhouse, to build a new clubhouse. I don't know where it came from, but the SH1T hit the fan anyway with the lockout, and everything started well from there. So we got planned mission anyway over the next couple of years. I may not have the correct dates and all that right, but never let the truth get in the way of a good story, you know. So anyway, we got the planned mission, and we, Richard Winches, you wouldn't believe, came and said to us he would design the clubhouse. We sort of guided him. I'm sure Matt was very much involved in the guidance of what we wanted, and the other lads that were in the know in those days. But Richard designed the clubhouse for us. We couldn't believe the big turn we had made with the Wenches family. So around what, maybe late 94, we started to build, and this was unbelievable. A small club like us looking to build something in the region of 120,000. But it transpired that we actually built it for around 48 or 52,000, you know, and that was because everyone gave the time. I remember the Scobie's big yellow JCB coming in and digging out the foundations, and everyone throwing in the muck, as we called it. And everyone helped out, you know. I probably shouldn't name any names, but everyone helped out. And the crack we had, every waking minute in our spare time, we got stuck in and built the clubhouse. There were block layers, there were roofers, carpenters, they were all there, and labourers, and it was a great time for the club, and it sort of brings out what the club is about, the great camaraderie we had, the great community spirit, and that really epitomised what this club is, those maybe that couple of years building the clubhouse or from top to bottom.
Right, in 1996, with the new clubhouse ready, the Hills aimed to win a competition. And they played Rush in the semi-final of the Cup, and one of the stars on that day was Noel Harper.
Thanks very much, Jim. Just before I say anything about it, I'm coming to the hills from, say, the early 70s, in going back to the historical end of it. And not alone did players play football in the morning and cricket in the afternoon, but they also went home and got up on combines and combined the night away. So just a little thing that people should be maybe aware of. There was a couple of things that maybe needed to mention. Paddy Byrne, one day we were playing in Terenure, CYM Terenure, and he just failed to take all 10 wickets in the match. The 96 semi-final was a match that I probably will always remember for a few things other than taking the 5 wickets. And Naz, glad to see you here. You were the prize wicket of the 5. In your first year with Rush. Matt Sheridan, I think, might have been playing in that, but was playing for Rush. He was actually playing with the Hills when I came to the Hills first. But after taking the wickets, it was a kind of an anti-climax in the sense that Rush batted first, and I think they were somewhere around 150 for 4. And I think it was 50 overs bowled. And somebody, I believe somebody said to Matt Dwyer, for Jesus' sake, give Harper a bowl. You didn't give him a bowl all day, give him a bowl. So the rest is history on it. But coming off at the end of the match, a great friend of mine said to me, good man Harper, you can't keep a good man down. And that man was Tony Dwyer, who just passed recent. And I always remember him for that. He had many words of wisdom. He was actually the archives of the Hills for a good many years. He carried them around with him in the chair. So I think he was forced to put us up on computer.
Thanks very much, Noel. 1996 was a great year. The Hills was given the honour of hosting the Senior Cup final. The first team won the Wigan's Teep League at Malahide, and after Noel's heroics, we played Pembroke in the final. Pembroke were the hot favourites because they had a professional player, we had none. This was a wonderful day in the history of the club. The ground and the new pavilion looked great, and there was a marquee in place to feed the multitudes. The Hills batted first and scored 200 runs. Pembroke were never really in the game, and the Hills had won the Leinster Senior Cup for the second time. To add to all this glory, Matt Dwyer won the Leinster Cricket Union's award for the best all-rounder in 1996. The Fingal clubs had long argued that their best players were being ignored for international recognition. Marguerite Burke was our first international in 1993. And now, in 1996, Declan Moore was the first Hills male player to be capped for Ireland. In 1998, at last, Matt Dwyer received his long-awaited and richly deserved Irish cap. By the end of the decade, Barry Archer and Paul Mooney had also been picked for Ireland. So we now had 5 senior international cricketers. It's a pleasure to welcome John Morgan here this evening. John was our coach for 2 years.
I will talk to you about the Hills Cricket Club. What a lovely club to be associated with for 2 years. And the fellas here, including, I'd like to just say something about Mark Clinton. We played one night up in the Phoenix Park, and the monkeys had to put helmets on in the zoo. He hit that many sixes. That's the type of players they had here. Great commitment. I have a better memory about you, Matt. We were out here one day, and Matt, you're getting 50s, you should go on and get 100. If you want to play out here, he said, you better get yourself registered. The match that we played, we had Pembroke 57 for 7. And there was a catch taken by Mick Dwyer behind, and of course, the umpire didn't see it. And they got 150 or whatever it was, and we lost the match. But still, it was a great team to be associated with, and great players, and a wonderful club, Jim, to be associated with for 2 years. Thank you.
During the late 1990s and at the start of the new century, the Hills had a very successful second 11, and Martin Byrne was captain during some of those years.
Yeah, it was a great time, Jim. We had a great time. I think we hit 6 finals in 7 years. But more importantly than that, a lot of us guys who are growing too old for first team cricket got to play with the up and coming senior cricketers and our own families as well. I know Sean played with his lad Paddy and Darren and Patrick on the team, and I had Robert and a few more lads like that. Mal and I came into the team. And it was a great time for that. It was a great privilege to be able to play with the lads. And we had a successful time. Don't remember too much about the games. One little incident that happened. The Hills got the senior 2 final here in the Hills to stage on our own ground. John Andrews was captain, and he said to me at the start of the season, "These Curly, wouldn't it be great to win the cup on your own ground?" And sure, lo and behold, Luke got 8 wickets in the final here, and that was that. So we had a lot of bangers on that team as well, yeah, man. So that's about it, Jim. We had a great time. It was a privilege to play with the lads coming up, and we all enjoyed ourselves.
The Hills won the Leinster Senior Cup in 2005 and 2006, and John Wills, the club coach, was the architect of these victories. Joseph Clinton will give his insights on this very successful period for the club.
Yeah, I can't say enough about John and John Wills, an absolutely phenomenal coach. Well to knowledge, he brought discipline, said the right things at the right time, a man that was hugely respected, and he certainly got the best out of any of the teams that he was involved with. We, just to add some context to 2005 and that year, we were relegated in 2004, and we probably had a difficult time from we were promoted in 2003 and relegated in 2004. So we did well in 2003, but we struggled. We were, you know, battling with how we were going to deal with sides who were, you know, dominated by overseas players. And it was a difficult time for the club. And looking at the side in 96 and the sides right the way through prior to that and up to 2000s, all homegrown players, all local committed players, which was great to see. But, you know, it was a battle and we struggled for a couple of seasons. So anyway, look, in 2005, leading into that season, Nor County had an exceptional side. Clontarf were exceptional as well. They were the two sides to beat. Trent Johnson was captain of the Clontarf side. Jeremy Bray was playing in the Clontarf side. Trent leading into the final that year. The final was in Nor County. Trent was in New York. So myself and Luke and Patrick Byrne were playing in the side. Certainly three lads that were at a wedding the night before. Brendan Byrne got married and we were at the reception in the Cock Inn in on the way to Julianstown. And it had rained for 48 hours, torrential rain that night. We all were pretty sure the game wasn't going to be played the next day in Nor County. Anyway, we turned up, woke up. Dad woke me up early and said, "Jesus, you can't believe it. It's, you know, the sun's going to shine today, son. You know, we've a chance of a game. Not necessarily a chance of winning, because we'd been completely annihilated by Clontarf in a final earlier in the year in Pembroke. It was the 50 over, or the Wigan's Teep equivalent early in the season. And we were completely annihilated, total mismatch. So certainly the underdogs going into the final. Trent flew in that morning, Trent Johnson, jet lagged, turned up, press some flesh. And I have a lot of time for Trent now. Great guy, and he's done a huge amount for Irish cricket, and very well respected guy. But he was he didn't have so much sleep the night before. Struggled on the flight on the way over. Toss went up anyway. He won the toss and decided to bat. And I was delighted anyway. I said, fair enough. Okay, go for it. And we got stuck into them. We had them a lot of wickets down for not so many runs. And Greg Mullins came in to bat and struggled. Hit one back to Barry Archer. Cotton bowled. Ball thrown in the air. We were delighted. We were going in the right direction and not out. Couldn't believe it. He stood there and anyway, it happened and we had to get on with it. It took us a long time to get over it. We bitched and moaned for a while, as sometimes you do. Forgive my language. But it was given not out. He went on to get 99. Thankfully, he didn't get 100. And they got to a score of, Jim, I'm sure you can tell me what Clontarf ended up with. Anyway, looking at the man to, as we look at it to my left, Bryn Thomas, played a phenomenal innings with Patrick Byrne as well. They got stuck in, but Bryn managed to get a phenomenal 100 and we chased the score down. The following year, we managed to get to the senior final again, which we were delighted with. We'd been promoted from Section B to Section A and we were going in the right direction. Bryn took on the captaincy and we played North County in the final in Merion. And Michael O'Hurley there, yeah, got a good catch in the deep on the boundary. He was pretty happy with that anyway. And it was a game that was rain affected. We had to come back on the Monday night to finish the game. Connor Armstrong missed out on 100, but got North County to a good score of 240, maybe 250, possibly even 260. We were looking good, chasing it. Michael Lax and Patrick Byrne batted very well together. We lost a couple of wickets, and when we came back, it was tricky, but we got home in the end. A phenomenal night, and two really good years. Got us back on track and got us back to some success at top level, and we had a really good night here, which finished at maybe 6:30 in the morning. It was a pretty special night on the Monday night. So the crowd again, the support from all the fans was phenomenal, and it's great to see Tony Dwyer to the right there, to the front. You know, an unbelievable supporter of the club over the years, and to me, and just loved chatting to anyone who played, anyone that was there, you know, and I loved chatting to Tony about the games. It was great, you know, and he certainly enjoyed that night, that's for sure.
The Fifths also won a cup in 2006, and Mark McGuire is going to speak to us about that famous team.
Well, it don't mean a lot about the game. All I can remember is wherever runs we were chasing, Paddy was one end batting and Joe was the other, and Paddy had a limp and Joe had a limp, and if there was three runs to be got normally, it was only one. But in fairness to the two of them, they got the runs and we won the game. I don't remember a lot of the game, but that fifth team and that year, the crack was just 90, you know, with Paddy Byrne and that. And that's all really I remember about that game, really.
Caroline Archer will talk to us about women's cricket in the Hills during the more recent past.
Yeah, probably. I think the lead up to that was probably a little bit more memorable. But that was the first year that we had our own paid player, I suppose, in kind of in keeping with the men. And Ciara Metcalf had come in. She was our first kind of person who'd been heavily involved in international cricket here as well. And that particular year, we had both Ciara and Katie Gurry, who is now playing with the White Ferns over in New Zealand. Who worked, and both of them worked really, really hard with all of our own players to get them to the Senior Cup final. And it was a fantastic day, really, really memorable. I know I got presented with a lovely top from all the girls. Ciara did that as well. So brilliant, and we will definitely get there again.
Max Sorensen joined the Hills Cricket Club in 2007 as our overseas player. He's going to describe the build-up to the 2012 Bob Kerr Irish Cup campaign and the different games during that year, culminating in the great win in the final.
So yeah, 2012, good year. First Irish Cup won. Heard enough about it. God bless Flash, but I was development officer that year, and for about 5 years, Flash used to, I'd come into the clubhouse over here, have a cup of coffee before I start my coaching or whatever, and Flash would be sitting and goes, Jesus, when are we going to win the All-Ireland? And I'd heard that for 5 years, like, consistently, every day, every time I come in, I'm like, Flash. Every time the years before we get knocked out, I'd be like, maybe next year, maybe next year. But anyway, yeah, so that year, we had got to the semi-finals. We're heavy underdogs against Waringstown in Waringstown. Remember the day like it was yesterday. We were down in the Nets training, getting ready for the match, and the Nets were down the bottom. And then I'll never forget, like, I had the best feeling ever. We're having Nets, we're hitting balls, and all of a sudden the Heels freaking bus turns up, and you just see everyone walking up, and there must have been about... Everyone was pretty lashed at this point as well. It was only 11 o'clock in the morning. The game hadn't even started. And there was a big noise coming up the ground. And I heard everyone, and everyone was so excited. And I thought, geez, this is going to be a good day. So we ended up, I don't know, I can't remember if we won the toss or lost the toss, but we bowled first. And we rolled Waringstown, the mighty Waringstown, for I think it was like 88 runs. Nazzy got 6 for nothing as usual, and and he actually bowled a guy where the guy that was commentating actually said he didn't really remember how he was out because it was their pro. That's how bitter they were. So we absolutely steamrolled them with the ball, and then we chased it down pretty easily with 3 wickets down, 7 wickets in hand, and that meant we got to play Marion in the final in Clontarf. So. Turned up that day, that was also an awesome game, controversial game as well. We won, did we win the toss? Yeah, we won the toss, I think, bowled. Another day, won the toss, batted, and they came out and absolutely, excuse my language, blocked the shit out of it. They were 11 runs after 11 overs for no wickets, and we were like sitting there going, what the heck is going on here? So we... We'd obviously bowled Tide, myself and Naz were opening the bowling. They then got a bit of a... I think Mark then came on and got 2 quick wickets and they were in trouble at the start. Then Dom Joyce put on a bit of a partnership. He sort of batted throughout the whole game. Got a very slow 50 runs that sort of got them to a competitive target, but he was controversially run out without the ball. Because in the semi-final, just to talk about a thing, during that cup finals, there was 2 bits of controversy. In Mary Waringstown, they accused Nicholas, who was sitting here on my right, of knocking the stumps over with the ball standing up to the stumps. So they thought that's how their pro was bowled. So they thought Nicholas cheated, and they actually told him that. And actually Alistair Bush, I think, wrote it in the paper or something like that. And then in the final, Dom was running for a second run, and Nicholas may or may not have dropped the ball after knocking the stumps over. But it was pretty irrelevant because they're only getting about 170 anyway. So we then ended up chasing that down with 7 wickets in hand again, pretty easily, and that was our first Irish Cup win. But yeah, that was a great day. That was our first win, and to mark the occasion, I gave Flash my medal because I knew how much he wanted that All Ireland win. So that was that.
Max mentioned Nazir Shaukat, and Naz will talk to us about his experience of playing with the Hills Cricket Club.
2012, that was the final. After we get when it comes to Hills, everybody talk about when we're going to win Irish Cup. Everybody's saying this every year, but then when we become a captain, that was my first year, I think. And when we won the final, and Matt Dwyer, he come to me, and thank you, Nazzy, hug me. And after that, Flash was standing behind him, and he hugged me. He just said one thing I remember, never forget. He said, Naz, I will die with the peace now. But But I have to say thank you very much for believing in me always. Like, you know, this is a great club, great people. I always enjoy here, you know. Thank you very much.
The successes on the playing field were matched by obtaining the freehold of the vineyard. Matt Dwyer will take us through that process.
I suppose to fill you in on the background of before we purchased the land was Treasury Holdings, who were Johnny Ronan, a big developer in Dublin, decided to buy the Wenches out for a huge amount of money. The Tiger was running around the country. I think there was three or four of them actually running around the country. But the Wenches sold the land to Treasury Holdings. And at a meeting here, Treasury held to allay fears with the people from the area to say that they were going to build two golf courses and 60 or 70 houses and a hotel, and they had their models and plans and everything. And at that meeting, we were told that we were going to get the grounds passed over to us as a sort of a gratitude, and the school also an area for the car park. So that was great for the club. But work started on the Wenches land to develop the golf courses, but unfortunately Mr. Tiger left the country fairly quickly and everything fell by the wayside, and Treasury Holdings went into NAMA, and as a result our promise went into NAMA with it. So after a number of years of negotiations with Treasury, unfortunately their hands were tied and NAMA were sort of the big boys, and they didn't want to play ball with the Hills. They couldn't be seen to be handing over ground for nothing, because they had fingers in the pies all over the country. So if they did that, they'd be giving out land everywhere around the country. So we went into negotiations with NAMA to purchase the land. And as you normally do, you get valuations on the land. And of course, NAMA were being represented by a D4 company, and D4 prices weren't really relevant out on the north side of Dublin and Skerries. So they told us that the land was worth about 80 or 90,000. And we sort of said, come on, there's land being sold here for about 10 or 12,000 an acre agricultural land. So we valued we got our valuation on the land from one of the local auctioneers here in the town. And we said, by the way, we've been here for sort of 30, 40 years, and there's sporting rights, and there's all sorts of ifs and buts and ands about it. So we made them an offer of 25,000 for the land. So there was a few negotiations going on, and we ended up, we agreed to purchase the land for 25,000. Now, we didn't get it for nothing, but it was a cheap purchase in the end, and hopefully it's paid off by now. I'm sure it is. But it was sort of a tough time. Like, you know, people were saying, why should we pay for it and all this sort of thing. But I think that the right decision was made in the end, and it gave us a foothold here on our land. And we can cut the hedge now whenever we wish, like, you know. So it was good times.
Nicholas Pretorius was our wicketkeeper for a number of years. He has fond memories of the 2012-2014 Bob Kerr Cup wins.
I just want to go back to 2012 quickly. A lot of things obviously happened there. But I'll never forget Mossy's cover drive in the third round against YMCA. Mossy hadn't ever hit a cover drive all season. And I actually still don't think he has ever since. But he hit it just past Alan Lewis. And we tied the game at 157 each because we had lost less wickets we went through. That brought us to Waringstown, as Maxie said. The atmosphere was amazing, and Nazzy bowled the guy, just to let you all know. Amazing final, amazing feeling winning it for the first time. Knew what it meant to the club, and knew what it felt like just coming back here and celebrations. So I remember 2012 very fondly. 2014 was a bit of a blur season for us. I think we got relegated from Division 1 that season. But we somehow snuck through all the rounds, maybe got a lucky draw here and there. And we got North Down in the semi-final, up in North Down, where Maxi, I think you scored 70 runs that day. Absolutely bongoed it. And Nazi defended, I think, 4 or 5 runs in the last over. Again, as he does, as everyone said tonight. And then in the final, we just had too much for Clontarf. I think Cormo, you scored 7 yard in that game, and we just had too much for them. And that's a great feeling winning two All Islands with the Hills.
The Hills Cricket Club has always had a strong commitment to youth cricket. From the early 70s, when Gerry Byrne presented a cup for youth cricket in Fingal, to Joe Caprani coaching in the 1970s onwards, the late Joe Clinton, who had always a strong commitment to youth cricket. What we're going to see now in the next clip will be lots of photographs of our boys and girls playing cricket. And Joseph is going to talk specifically about the All-Ireland in 2016, but will also mention the people who have done so much for youth cricket in the Hills over the years.
We hosted the Leinster Cup Final to qualify for the All-Ireland in the MCG, our second ground. We played CSNI here, and Stephen Dyer brought a side down, and they had high hopes, but we lost a couple of wickets. We got stuck in, we consolidated, we ended up getting a pretty good score of maybe 140, and it ended up being a good enough score to win. Adam Clinton had an exceptional day. He ended up getting 94 in the game, which, you know, I certainly, as a dad, was very proud of him. But the team, right the way through from first game of the Cup in Leinster to qualify, right the way through, we had game after game where another individual would step up and put in a match-winning performance. So, looking at the coaches there, we had myself, Mark, and Paul Smith, and we've Alan Carell beside me that continue to work with that group. So, in addition to that group, we've a lot of really, really good kids coming through. Wednesday night works really well here, which is an introduction to cricket. Luke, my brother, got hugely involved with that this year, and that's what it's all about, because Wednesday nights, we got to get kids involved. We got to keep this club as strong as it is at the moment. And without the kids that are up there that we're looking at now, without the kids on Wednesday night starting off, you know, the club isn't going to continue to be the strong club it is right now, unless we embrace our youth section and continue to support it.
Cormac McLaughlin Gavin has been a key player for the club, and he will talk to us now about the Cup win in 2017.
Yeah, so 2017, we had a particularly strong team that year. I remember we had a couple of overseas guys in, so we had Sean Terry, Ryan Cartwright, and Yakub Ali. So the big highlight that year was the Leinster Senior Cup here in the Hills. Again, we were trying to pull up the scorecard, so we actually couldn't find it. But I do remember the day very clearly in that, we bowled well, as we always had that year. Ryan, Nazi, and Maxi. You weren't? Maxi? Yeah, Maxi was keeping, I forgot. We had bowled well. Marion had a particularly strong batting lineup as well, so we did well to restrict him to a total. I'd say it was a little over 200. And then with the batting, I remember I poked around, as I usually do, got us about 30. And then towards the end, I think there was about 10 overs to go, and it was getting particularly tight. And Maxi basically came in and took the game away from Marion. I remember John Anderson took an amazing catch at mid-wicket. I think that was actually to get rid of Ryan. He was doing a bit of damage at the time. And when Ryan was gone, we kind of, you know, our heads were down, but Maxi just kept sending him into archers. So before we knew it, we were lifting the Senior Cup. So that was an amazing day. Again, because it was at the Hills, to win the final in the Hills was particularly special. Another great year for the club, and one I'll never forget, I know, as a player.
Tomás Rooney Murphy was captain of the first during our 50th anniversary season, and we hosted the final at the Vineyard.
Yeah, I suppose just to talk about the season, I think the biggest thing from this season was probably it felt like a bit of a changing in the guard. there was a distinct lack of South Africans around the place for my time here. There's two of them sitting in the corner behind me. But no, I think in February of this year, we were, you know, we didn't know where we were going to be in the season. There was a lot of things still up in the air. And thankfully, I think come April, we had a decent team in place. And we took it from there. There was a couple of new faces around the place. And there was, I suppose, a breath of fresh air, which we tried to carry into the season. The highlight of the season, obviously, was, again, a bit of deja vu from 2017. We had the Senior Cup final here. We had a good run up to that. I think from listening and being involved in the games, we talked about the All-Ireland finals. We always based it on a good bowling attack. And I think, you know, nothing really changed this year. We running up into the Senior Cup final was obviously a new format, but we really based it on a good bowling attack. I think two highlights, obviously, Luke, I think, got 7 wickets against North County, am I right? Was it 7, Luke? So, yeah, it was obviously a big performance. But, no, and then obviously another massive performance that I'm sure everybody will remember was Naz in the final. Unfortunately, there's not a whole lot of dialogue to be said about the final. Basically, Naz bowled, they didn't get too many runs, and then we went out and knocked them off, but... just listening to the stories here, Naz is featuring in a lot of them, and I suppose just to mention the great man himself again, to be doing it over literally the span of 20 years, still be at the top of the game, making an impact in Senior Cup finals after people talked about him. People talking about him, I think, there in 1995, so fair play to Naz. But, yeah, I think that was the highlight of the season last year. We finished 3rd in the league, and I think that was a respectable finish as well. A lot of people sort of had the knives out when we looked like we were losing players, and, yeah, I think it turned out to be a pretty good season in the end.
Matt Dwyer is going to speak to us about the contribution which people from outside the immediate area have made to our club.
Over the years, I think the Hills have been extremely lucky with the number of people who come in the door. We spoke about the community we have and so on, but an amazing number of people came in the door into the Hills, and we were very lucky. Now, I am going to mention a few names because I think they had a significant input into the Hills. I remember coming to meetings, executive meetings here in the Hills, and we spoke for an hour and a half. One person took minutes, wrote them down, and we listened to them the next 2 or 3 weeks later. A certain person walked in the door in the name of Michael Chance, who came to a meeting, an executive meeting, and he looked around and he said, how do you guys sort of know what you're going to do tomorrow when we decide what everyone's doing for the next week or two? So at the next executive meeting, Michael Chance arrived with 10 biros and 10 notepads, and he handed them around to people. So you could write down what you were supposed to do for the next month. Now, the next month he arrived with another 10 because we all left him behind us. But eventually we got the gist of what meetings were about. You wrote down what you were supposed to do and you arrived then. He was just one person. We had Dick Burke who arrived. He was in the bank in Skerries, and he got involved he was the treasurer here for a number of years. Tony, my own brother, arrived and became the treasurer, became the statistician, became the guru of internet and all that, and he moved us forward. There are a number of other people. We've had Ray Daly, with John Morgan, who we heard from, with John Wills, who helped us with the coaching. Joe Caprani, long before that, helped us with coaching. People who are not part of this community, but ended up part of this community. Also, I'd like to mention also the people who come in from overseas. We never really went down the road of a hard-going professional as such. We got a friend of a friend coming from a club back in South Africa, in Australia, wherever, in Pakistan, India, wherever it might have been. And I see 3 people here in particular tonight who have fitted into our sort of community seriously well and have contributed hugely to our club, not only with runs and wickets, which we asked them to do, but with also just being part of what we're about. For example, Max Sorensen arrived from South Africa. his first night in the Hills Cricket Club. He wasn't drinking here in the Hills. He was at Mass. It was his first night. Now, he might have had a pint after the Mass. But that was the sort of people who came into this community. And there's loads and loads and loads of others that come up from Skerries who are not really, shall we say, within this community, but ended up. And one great man that I'll finish the note on was the legend in Sean Gilbride, who embraced this club with a serious heart. And whilst we're a fantastic community, the people who come into us from outside became as special as all the people in this community as well. So I'd like to say thank you very much to all those people who contributed, who weren't actually originally part of this community. Thank you.
I would like to say it is a great privilege for me to have this honour to present Maureen Bourne with a bouquet of flowers.
Take me back to the Black Hills of Dakota, to the beautiful Indian country that I love.
And when I get that lonesome feeling and I'm miles away from home,
I hear the voice of the mystic mountains calling me back home. So take me back to the Black Hills, the Black Hills of Dakota, to the beautiful Indian country that I love, to the beautiful Indian country that I love.